that would be great to give full attention to the next teacher. Excellent. So this is a kind of a, Aaron's was a great introduction in terms of a lesson to aspects of the PSF, which Josh Meyers will now pick up in talking about the atmospheric contributions to the PSF. Okay, go ahead, Josh.
Yeah, no. Better? Got it. where was I? So no Python, but there will be lots of little breakout sessions. I think I counted 8 different times here where you'll get to talk to your neighbor and answer a question. So hopefully you'll get to hear them more than you get to hear me. So with that in mind, I'm going to start with just a warm-up. Okay, so get together in groups of 3 or so, and then I just want you to go through these 3 statements and decide if they're true or false, and then if they're false, why is the statement false? So telescopes turn angles into positions, the PSF and the wavefront contain the same information, and the PSF does not depend on the object being imaged. So I'll give you chat, and I'll give you a few minutes. Sometimes. Which one is sometimes?
The last one.
Does not depend. Sometimes. Okay.
So I was thinking if your image was either like all white or all black with no variation, then the PSF wouldn't depend on that.
Okay.
Well,
so if you're just looking at the sky, an empty, like during the daytime or something.
Yeah, or you're doing a dome.
A dome flat. Yeah, I'd have to think harder about that one. Yeah. I have something else in mind, but. Yeah. Yeah. I see one. One answer. Yeah. True, false, false. Telescopes. False. Does not depend. I think that's right. I think that's what I decided. Anyway. Okay, that's probably enough time. So let's. Attention back at the front for a moment. So let's go through these. Who wants to reply to, say, number 1? Telescopes turn angles into positions.
Make Aaron answer.
Aaron, yeah. Yeah, that's my favorite description of a telescope, even before Aaron drilled that into us this morning. Well, yeah, okay. Number 2, the PSF and the wavefront contain the same information.
No.
This one's complicated. Yeah, I see a big thumbs down from Jim. I'll come back to this in a second. And then the third one, the PSF does not depend on the object being imaged.
No.
False. Why? Yeah, I forgot to ask why. Yeah, chromatic effects is a big one. Brighter, fatter is one. What was that?
It's a really big object, really big. The PSF is a function of x and y, so the bigger the object, the more you're going to get.
For a sufficiently large object, yeah, sure. Okay, so we didn't answer number two. I think the answer to number two is probably false. It sort of depends on, well, there are some details. So here's the wavefront, and then here's the PSF. This is the same equation Aaron showed us this morning. So for one thing, all we really care about is the phase of the wavefront, right? So we can add sort of multiples of 2 pi over lambda to it and end up with the same PSF. So we certainly lose that information. One thing I haven't actually decided in my head is if that's the only information you lose or not, right? So in principle, we're mapping a two-dimensional function wavefront into a two-dimensional function point spread function. And just mathematically, if you knew I precisely, could you invert this and find W up to an unknown phase? I don't actually know. Well, I'm sure the absolute value squared makes it more complicated.
There are a number of techniques developed to do this.
Yeah.
The catchword is wavefront retrieval. And actually, just since it's well mentioned, it applies not only to our case here for telescopes, but the people at the rest of this lab who do X-ray diffraction use the same kind of formalism and do the same kind of wavefront retrieval, actually. Even though it's quantum mechanics there.
Sure. Okay, so complicated anyway. Okay. Okay, and then Aaron already went through this, but I just wanted to point out one addition to the cartoon here, which is that I'm concerned with the atmosphere. So all of my wavefront aberrations are actually already in these in the light as it sort of enters the telescope, and then they persist after being worked on by the telescope. Yeah, so this is just the Fourier optics PSF. This does not include brighter, fatter, certainly. Yeah. And it's also instantaneous. It doesn't include any integration over time.
In practice, you're doing a time average.
Yeah, that's right. So the nominal exposure time is 15 seconds, and the PSF will be changing during that time, primarily due to the atmosphere. And we're just getting an average. All right. Okay. So let's move on to the source of those atmospheric phase differences. These all originate basically because the refractive index of air here, it's almost one, but it's got this small correction. And more importantly, that small correction actually depends on the density of the air that the light is traveling through. So any small differences in density are going to introduce these wavefront phase differences into the wavefront. So here's question number two. So imagine, I have these nice perfect plane waves coming in, and I hit a cell of warm air. So I just have a little blob of air here that's warmer than the surrounding ambient air. And then my question for you is, so first, on your whiteboard, draw what happens to this wavefront as it propagates further to the right. And then two, why am I so concerned about temperature but not pressure? So go for it.
Pressure stays stays the same because the pressure goes up.
Do we need whiteboards over here? You guys don't have whiteboards. Are you, do you have at least something you can sketch on? Do you have a drawing?
We're thinking about doing the ray tracing.
Interesting. Okay. Interesting. Okay. Yeah. The other way is just what is the velocity inside the blob compared to outside the blob.
But there's a lot of things that will happen. Right? Like I was thinking, at the edges of the blob, there's going to be a rising angle.
That's more detail than I'm looking for. Yeah. If it helps, this could be a rectangular blob. Don't worry about the curvature of the blob. Okay, I see one drawing, I see another drawing. No drawing? Still thinking? Okay, I see a few drawings, so let's bring it back together for a moment here. Would you like to share your drawing? and explain what's going on, maybe. Yes, yeah, sorry. Here, I can show it, yeah. That might work better. Okay, is this the orientation? Yeah. Okay, do you want to explain?
Sure, so the refractive index is lower in the blob, and so the rays are going to fan out. And so it's going to
right.
Like a bubble.
Okay. So yeah, so that was, I'll show you what I drew, which was much less detail than that. But I think that the important point is just that warmer air, so smaller refractive index, or smaller pressure, smaller refractive index, so propagates faster. The speed of light is faster in that blob. Anybody think about why the temperature matters but the pressure doesn't? True.
The volume will change, right? If the pressure was higher there, it would just spread out. So the volume will change with the temperature.
Yeah, so it's so the atmosphere is basically in pressure equilibrium. The way I think of this is that the speed of sound is just much faster than the speed at which these, you know, regions of different pressure can develop. So any pressure differences very quickly will come into equilibrium. Temperature differences that will persist for a while, and so we're mostly interested in temperature differences for this atmospheric turbulence.
But there are pressure differences like lows and highs in the weather.
Sure. Much larger than the beam of a telescope, though, yeah.
So what about your wind shear?
Not compared to the temperature, I think. The temperature is the dominant effect. Okay.
So when I'm in an airplane and I'm going through terrible turbulence, is that scale on a much different scale than what you're describing here?
Sure. The scale we're mostly interested in here is of order the size of the telescope aperture.
But it's comparable to the size of a plane.
Oh, but no, it's not just the angular distance. No, it's not the angular distance. Josh said is right. The beam, you know, an optical telescope has a beam. That beam is a cylinder the size of the primary mirror that runs through the whole atmosphere for any given direction of an object. Now, it's a slightly different cylinder.
This will come up again. But yeah, that's fine. Yeah. Okay, so let's move on. So this is the point at which I would normally start showing you simulations of atmospheric turbulence, but that seemed less exciting to me than actually getting some data. Now, partly this is because I showed a bunch of simulations at a meeting in December, and Chris Stubbs told me, you need to go get some data. I haven't gotten any data from Chris yet, but it does happen that I'm on the time allocation committee for one telescope, which is the telescope in my backyard, which I brought in for show and tell. And so I went out and, I don't know if you can see it in this picture, there's a little Canon camera here, just a digital SLR that I can hook up to the telescope. And I went out and got myself some data. So this is an image of Sirius. From this telescope with a commercial camera, and I was able to put it in the camera in movie mode, right? So I actually have a nice 24 frame per second video of Sirius from my backyard. Okay, and you can see it flickering. Let me just slow it down and go frame by frame a little bit. So you can see it's changing not just the brightness, which I think is pretty apparent, but the shape there is also very, rapidly, I guess, changing. So anyway, why is my next question for you. What effects can you think of that would affect, cause this image to change so rapidly? So in groups again. There's no physical shutter while it's running. It's just reading out. Yeah, I believe. I would hear it, I think, if there was a shutter. Yeah. Okay, let's see what people came up with. I came up with, I think, four or five different things. Suggestions. Why is the image changing so rapidly? The contamination in the air.
Some dust or some small particles.
Dust. So differences in sort of the transmission in the atmosphere. Okay. Other ideas? Yeah. The wind? Yeah, so the wind and, you know, these blobs of warm air, especially, are moving in the wind and changing the wavefront and therefore the point spread function, so the image of the star. I'll just show you the list I came up with here. So the atmosphere, obviously. Any vibrations, you know, my mount isn't that sturdy. So there can certainly be vibrations. Tracking errors, the telescope's probably not tracking the sky perfectly. There's shot noise. And then scintillation, which is another atmospheric effect besides the point spread function, that it's what causes twinkling in stars. It's sort of very rapid variations in brightness. Also due to sort of Fourier optics and diffraction. Okay, so that was fun, but what's even more fun is to throw the telescope out of focus. So Aaron mentioned that LSST will have these wavefront sensors at the corners of the focal plane, and I think in LSST's case, they're about a millimeter in and out of focus. For this image, I went all out and moved it about a centimeter here, so you know it can have a pretty wide throw here. And a centimeter produced this image of Sirius. Now that's defocused, and so you can take a movie of that too, right? So I think what you're mostly seeing here are these blobs of different refractive index in the atmosphere blowing in the wind. And I think my eyes even, I can sort of see a dominant direction on that movie. Yeah, so it's a color camera. So yeah, in principle, you can learn something chromatic from this. I haven't thought too hard about that. We will talk a little bit about wavelength dependence in a bit. The plates, well, in focus, it's about 1 arcsecond per pixel. I'd have to do some math to figure out. It's F5 or 6, something like that. Yeah. Yeah, so it's a commercial color camera, so there's a microfilter array of filters of, you know, our red, green, and blue microfilters across the pixels. Yeah, sure, yeah.
So if you did this on different nights and the wind was blowing at a different speed each night, do you think you would see a different...
Be able to pick that out? I don't know. I haven't tried it experimentally. Maybe. Yeah, given the fact that there appears to be a particular direction on this movie, I think that might work.
Can we do a correlation between the frequency change of this picture with the speed of wind and see?
Right. So the question was, can we figure out, you know, what is the wind speed from analyzing this image? Right. Yeah. Oh, you mean look, use wind measurements from, you know, a weather service or something and try to correlate that with this movie. And then use that as evidence that wind is really what's going on here. That's a good idea. Yeah.
Basically said that these things come from convection cells, right? So you're
yeah.
hot going up and then coming back down. And
right.
So if there was no wind, would we still see this kind of effect just from the movement of these?
Well, as long as there's some, you know, evolution in the turbulent structure in the atmosphere, I think you would see something. Now, whether you choose to call that evolution wind or not, I don't think matters.
I don't think we've been able to arrange it for that either.
Yeah. In practice, there will be wind.
Something static.
One part of the focal plane.
Well, imagine so yeah, that so up in the sky and over here.
Yeah, so some of this may make sense in a minute. Yeah. Okay, let's keep going. Okay. So Aaron already talked about this a bit, which was my next question, which is this more representative of what's going on in the focal plane or what's going on in the pupil plane? And I'll just skip ahead. Even though we're only, 1 centimeter away from the focus in this case, I think this image is more representative of what's going on in the exit pupil than what's going on in focus, which is maybe a little counterintuitive. But that's all I have. and so one way you can prove this, though, is the following. Right.
Why does it look brighter around the edges?
Around the edge of the ring? That must be a diffractive effect. I don't, it probably depends on exactly how much in or out of focus I am. Around the hands, too, yeah. So, okay. And then I have a few more fun things. So this is me breathing in front of the aperture, right? It was kind of fun, right? And if breathing's not enough, additional turbulence for you, I also brought out this. The heat gun. Right, so it's fun, and it's important to note that, when you're looking at my breath or the heat gun, sort of, directly, it's completely transparent. Right, this is not a transparency issue. This is entirely due to differences, heat and my breath, composition related differences in refractive index, evolving in front of the aperture there. That was, yeah, word for word. Yeah, okay, so this is fun too. There it is. Right. I it kind of was this funny kidney shape. I haven't thought about that yet, but I don't know that I was that careful for one thing. Yeah, very, very well could be. But yeah, so adding that extra turbulence does have a big effect on the point spread function. And you can think of that if we go back to this Fourier picture that we're adding, high frequencies to the wavefront, and then if the PSF is the Fourier transform, then further away from the center of the PSF, that's where these high frequencies live, and so adding those high frequencies results in a larger PSF. Thinking it through the Fourier a bit there. So let's see what's next. Okay. So I had a question related to that. So I showed you what happens to a single star, what happens to Sirius when you blow the heat gun in front of the telescope. My question for you next is, what if Sirius had a neighbor, right? If there's another bright star right next to Sirius, what would the wavefront in that case look like, on either side? And then also, what would happen, as I move the heat gun further away from the aperture? Does that change, what happens to Sirius or the neighboring stars? So, any questions about the question first? I know that's a little complicated.
Is the heat gun get larger as you move it away?
The same heat gun. Okay, go for it. What did it look like? So that was my sketch in the middle. Yeah, that's my attempt to draw what was going on. You have pictures? Doodles? Yeah.
Potatoes.
Okay. Yeah. Okay.
Kind of at each point source, you see the same.
Are these the in focus or the out of focus images?
I guess these are the in focus ones.
Yeah.
Okay.
So out of focus is a good question.
Yeah, out of focus is
a
change of shape.
Two, 30, 45 minutes.
Yeah.
Do you guys have a drawing? Still thinking? Talking it over? Yeah.
Yeah. The idea that if you move the heat gun farther away, it
takes up a lot.
There's a smaller angular extent.
Unless the heat gun
is bigger. I mean, it's the same. Think of it of the cylinder of air towards the star. That, I mean, the heat gun is taking up the same fraction of that cylinder, sort of no matter where, what altitude you pair them up.
And I mean, the wavefront gets just messed up. If it gets messed up far away from the telescope, as it does.
Yeah. You've got lots of drawings.
What's the point spread? What's the scene? What's the atmospheric image quality of the scene?
In my backyard?
A
lot. I'm sure. Is it smaller than 11 centimeters? Probably.
11 centimeters is 1 arc second, I think.
That sounds close, anyway. Yeah. Yeah, it's got to be.
You're not seeing any diffraction, you're just seeing it.
That's a good conversion.
Yeah. For some wavelengths. Yeah. They're ready, you think? Okay, let's see what Josh thought. Okay, so for the two out of focus images, if the heat gun's right in front of the aperture, you know, right here, then it sort of doesn't matter what angle the actual star is at, because it's all seeing the same effect right in front of the telescope, right? So let's see, how did I fill this in? So for the heat gun right in front of the telescope, so here's like the aperture of the telescope, and here the red blob is me shooting the heat gun. So no matter which star I'm looking at, that the heat gun sort of falls right in the center of the aperture, right? So you get the same sort of diffraction or wavefront pattern across the field of view. Now if I move the heat gun away from the aperture, then all of a sudden when I look at the star on the left, the heat gun's only affecting sort of the right side of the wavefront. So that's this blob here. And then, you know, for the star right along the axis, it's the same. And then for the star on the right, only the left part of the cylinder of light going towards the star gets affected. So is everybody happy with that? I wanted to, but I got clouded out. Yeah, so no, not yet. Any questions before we move on? Yeah?
So what if you move the heat gun vertically further away? So the two stars will be resolved, because if you move further vertically and then...
Further...
So you're already moving vertically, but I think he's saying even more vertically.
Oh, if I move it, you know, way up here,
Yeah. You
mean? Yeah. I see. Yeah, in that case, you know, the stars on the sides will be basically unaffected by the heat gun. Okay, what comes next? Let's see. Okay, now here's where I get to actually show you some simulations. I've run out of questions to ask you on my backyard data. When we simulate the atmosphere in these codes like FOSIM or GALSIM, now has an atmospheric simulator, what we're doing is we're turning this 3D representation of the atmosphere into just a series of layers, mostly for computational reasons, right? We just can't store an entire three-dimensional array of turbulence. And then, just like that last example with the heat gun shows, the way we then turn these turbulent layers into point spread functions is we evaluate the impact on the wavefront in each layer along a cylinder with the size of the telescope aperture, and then just sort of take these little cutouts, right, from the turbulence, just like taking a cookie cutter and cutting out a cookie at one location in this 2D phase screen, right? And then we can do the Fourier optics, and then the additional wrinkle is that, of course, these layers are moving with wind in the simulation, so we have to repeat this over and over again with different time steps.
What's the color scale on the
plot? Of this turbulence? I stole this from a paper by G and Tyson. I don't remember if there was a color scale in that original figure or not, but it's phase, basically. We store this in phase, units of phase.
So yeah. Turbulence is modeled by the difference of the density.
Yeah.
So it's
So this is a Gaussian random field with a particular power spectrum that I wasn't going to go into, but yeah.
Mm-hmm. Does it matter whether the change in density is on the composition, like water vapor?
Yep. So water vapor can also change the refractive index of air.
So you're assuming the refractive index of air does not depend on frequency, that the phase change.
That's right. So in these simulations, generally we're not keeping track of refractive index as a function of wavelength in the turbulence. Yep.
So
which you could worry about. Actually, I don't know if FOSIM does that or not. If FOSIM has a model for phase as a function of wavelength, given a... Sorry, what? Probably enough to worry about it, especially, I mean, definitely enough to worry about when you go to away from the zenith direction, but for this purpose, I'm not sure. Yep. Okay, so here's some actual simulations now. So this is this 115 millimeter aperture like my telescope, and a particular value for the seeing. I think this is actually really good seeing. And so you can see.
And no pixels are small.
That's right. So the pixels are unimportant. I didn't intend to match the pixels to the actual pixel of the camera, in other words.
So you used a point source for that?
And then yeah. So basically, I did what was on that previous slide of looking at the wavefront, and then doing the Fourier optics integral, doing it over and over again, to develop this time series of what's going on. So yeah, so in this case the point spread function is dominated by the actual optics of the telescope, not by the atmosphere, because the atmosphere I simulated was pretty stable. Okay.
What's the frame rate?
I don't think it's quite the same. I think this is 15 frames per second. And the movie was 24. But it's also worth pointing out that this is actually instantaneous. In the movie, of course, it's actually integrating for 1/24th of a second for every frame. So it's a little bit different. In that regard. Okay, so using the same atmosphere, then we can look at what happens with, say, a 1 meter telescope. In that case, we get sort of this movie, and it's qualitatively different, right? All of a sudden, you can't really see the airy pattern anymore. We're dominated by the actual turbulence in the atmosphere because the airy pattern's gotten a lot smaller because we have the larger diameter telescope. Okay, and then just marching up. So now this is what it looks like for a 4 meter aperture telescope. Just play that a couple times. And then here is the whole LSST aperture telescope. So in this simulation, I actually showed what the phase from the atmosphere across the LSST pupil, which is sort of the annulus here on the right. And then here's the instantaneous PSF on the left. And you can see the phase, the wind slowly blowing the phase across the aperture in the simulation, and then what that does to the point spread function. The instantaneous point spread function. Okay.
So the right is basically the sum of those densities in those planes that you were showing us?
That's right.
And increasing the density, increasing the number of planes doesn't change that? So this is like the variance along a column?
Yeah, so the more, so sure, if you add more planes together, and each plane has the same amount of turbulence in it, then sort of the net effect will have more turbulence and a larger effect on the PSF. Is that your question?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, how do you decide on the number of planes as well?
Yeah, so that's a big open question for me. There are values for that people use, but I don't know personally, at least, what the motivation is for, say, using 6 layers versus 7 layers versus 3 layers. I think that could use further study. Well, what do you mean by converging, I guess.
So if you sum something up,
yeah,
then the integration, if you integrate, then the integration will converge. It doesn't depend on the rest
of the right. So I guess I should point out that the purpose of having the multiple planes isn't necessarily to have good resolution in the altitude direction. It's more that there are actual physical layers in the 3D atmosphere with wind moving in different directions, and we're just trying to characterize that. Is I think the main motivation for having the multiple planes. Yeah.
I think it would be maybe more correct to have a 3D phase pattern, which is the
so definitely
the turbulence is described in 3D, so you don't have to add.
And if so the question was, it'd be, or the statement was, it would be more correct to have a full three-dimensional atmospheric simulation.
And then looking to your images, although it's against a little bit what I knew or I have seen about the turbulences. I remember that was 20 years ago.
Uh-huh. Yes.
That was in the infrared, and of course, in infrared, it's slower. And basically, the first effect you see with a refresh rate of below a second, maybe fraction, or maybe a tenth of a second, or even faster, you move charges. That gives
yeah.
you this average effect over a long time.
That helps. Yes, and I think Aaron is actually working, or Adam is working with some adaptive optics data to make comparisons like that. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Josh, best question.
Yeah.
Reading assignment you gave us.
Yeah. That's right. So, okay, well, go ahead.
My question is, I'm just trying to understand what sets the size of those speckles.
That is the question.
So I won't say what it says here on this line. Then.
Okay, maybe I should read this,
maybe
though.
Maybe you should before you ask the question.
So in case you didn't know, these little blobs in the PSF here are called speckles. And so my next question for you to discuss in groups is what is setting the size of those speckles in a simulation like this? So go for it. You want to go backwards? Yeah. Okay.
Thank you.
horizon scale is like the differential size of the size increase. And then the amount of power that you can see depends on the aperture, right? Over all scales. So the bigger your telescope gets, the more speckles you'll see. Not because you have more scale information. It's not only pockets, but it's pockets of different things. There's also pockets of different sizes. So some pockets might be this big, some pockets might be this big. It's like a long list.
Okay, anybody come up with an answer? Yeah.
Someone set the parameter, so.
The parameter?
Somebody parameterized and said it should just be that size. That's right.
I put it in by hand. Okay. I did not put it in by hand. Other ideas? Yeah, Rahul.
How quickly heat is conducted in the atmosphere?
So something to do with the velocity. Okay. That's my answer. Yeah. Okay. So, Seth said it's the diffraction limit of the telescopes, and I think that's right. Basically, so remember that within a factor of absolute value squared, right? These two things are Fourier transforms of each other. So the smallest scales that you get over here depend on sort of the largest non-zero extent that you get in the wavefront, which in this case is just the diameter of the telescope. Okay, so the size of the speckles is set by the diameter of the telescope because that's essentially the aperture here is, you can think of this as the spatial frequency or angular frequency of what's going on in the point spread function. Yeah.
Did you say something about the units of the color scale, gradient?
Yeah. So that's this is W that Aaron talked about and that shows up in the Fourier transform or the Fourier optics equation. In this case, I've scaled it to the particular wavelength of the simulation and then put it into radians.
That's many wavelengths.
That's right. Yeah. So the atmosphere is nasty, but you get to average over it. So,
is each speckle actually an area function? It's really set by the diffraction.
The characteristic size is. I don't know that if, like, can you think of this as a sum of area functions? Is your question? Yeah.
Being shifted by one turbulent cell in the atmosphere.
It's an area function.
Yeah. Yeah, right. I don't know. I might, I mean, I have another video that might show that better. I don't. So here's one at a different wavelength and a different amount of turbulence in the atmosphere and a different time. It's moving slower, so you can kind of see what's going on here. And to me, those, you know, some of them are kind of elliptical. They don't look especially like the core of an airy function. But they are that characteristic size. So
if we shorten the observation, each frame of the time of each frame, will we see fewer and fewer speckles?
So these are basically instantaneous. So you will see a large number of speckles in an instantaneous PSF, zero integration time. I think that's right, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Especially in this picture, it looks like, I don't know if there are lines or rings, but it looks like
Yeah, there's structure, on larger scales too.
Like you see, like on the bottom, uh-huh. you see five little speckles yeah. on a line, right?
Yeah.
Isn't that linear diffraction occurring? That's thin slit diffraction.
Maybe. Yeah. So if you could, you could have to see it in the wavefront and see to figure out where that comes from, but.
It's an
annulus,
it's not a...
Yeah, it's, I don't know. Maybe, I don't know, is my answer, yeah. Okay, so more to cover anyway. I skipped chromatic. Okay, next question. So far we haven't looked too much at the wavelength here, so we have two lambdas that show up in the Fourier optics equation. So my next task for you is to figure out how does this instantaneous point spread function change with wavelength. Okay, and this is complicated, so here are some hints. You know, there's one factor of lambda that's sort of scaling the wavefront. And then there's another factor of lambda that's in this Fourier transform kernel. And I think it's helpful to sort of think of these independently. Yes?
We ignore the fact that the green filter is much worse than the red filter as far as its input into the PSF?
The green filter.
In real life.
Yes.
The different filters will have different effects on the PSF.
Oh, yeah. Ignore that. So imagine we're looking at different wavelengths in a single filter, if you want. Yeah. Okay. Which? I think he was worried about like focusing effects of the physical filters differences.
I think you just know that you've got the lambda 1/5 in there from the Kolmogorov. And that's why the CH works. Because I assume you have a
Kolmogorov. Yeah. It's Kolmogorov.
You told him to be Kolmogorov. Uh-huh. Ask him what he meant. Because
okay.
The reason why the optics is the worst is because of the lambda 1/5.
Yeah. That's right.
Welcome to Princeton, by the way.
Oh, thank you. Yeah.
I don't know if Jim told you, but we think we'll have you work on PSF estimations.
So. I kind of got that
like
impression.
A good
but yeah, sounds like fun.
Yeah, sounds like fun. It's a good close problem. And
right.
You've got error here. And,
uh-huh. Yeah. Yep.
And it matters.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yep. Are you watching the weather at all, Pat?
Or?
Okay.
I'll go out and take a look.
Okay. Normally,
22 minutes left.
Oh, okay. That's plenty of time. I think that's plenty of time.
The image size scene goes like lambda to 1/5.
Okay.
Never allow him to have any
extra resources. Yeah, he's cheating.
Because
cheating.
Yeah.
It's not an open book. Yeah, but where does it come from? That's the hard part. Right. Okay, people seem to be stumped. Let's just go through this. Okay, so here's how I decided to sort of decompose this problem. So let's look at one of those two factors of lambda at a time in isolation. So here's a sort of a simulation where I'm holding this factor of lambda that's this first lambda that's scaling the wavefront constant. Okay, and then I'm gonna look at what happens when I change just one of these lambdas. And in this case, I think it's helpful to note that Aaron mentioned that x, y, and uv were conjugate variables. I think it's actually helpful to keep the normalization in to answer this question. So divide by this is sort of the distance of the focal plane from the pupil, the z, And then lambda here is what's scaling in the pupil plane. And so it's really these two things that are Fourier conjugates. So what happens then in this Fourier transform kernel, if I this lambda is just a scaling, right? So if by changing lambda, if I increase lambda here in the pupil plane, then I have to decrease something in the focal plane to compensate. So anyway, here's the video of what happens when you change just that one lambda. If you look carefully, nothing's happening except the scale is changing.
This is always the same atmosphere, same instantaneous.
This is one instant in time, yeah. And so all that happens when you change this lambda is that you get a scale factor in the PSF, just isotropic dilation of the PSF. Now the other one, the other factor is trickier. So if we hold this part constant in the Fourier kernel and then just manipulate this lambda, the way I picture this is we're squashing the wavefront, right? We're making the wavefront closer and closer to zero, to flat, as we increase this lambda. And so that means we're sort of approaching diffraction limited optics, right? So this thing at 325 nanometers, as we increase the wavelength, is going to start approaching just an airy function. Now, it does it in a complicated way where you can see the speckles are merging, for instance, and it doesn't get there by 1100 nanometers, but it's on its way to becoming an airy profile in the limit that this lambda goes to infinity, basically. Now, it so happens that those two effects sort of very nearly cancel. So this is what it looks like when both effects are turned on, right? So you can see the dilation from the changing the lambda into Fourier kernel, and you can see the speckles merging as it becomes closer and closer to an airy profile. So it's actually should be getting better, but almost constant. So if you work,
if the power's moving in, but the wings are moving up, is that what I'm seeing? It looks like the light red is getting bigger, but the yellow is getting closer to the center. Or maybe I'm just seeing it.
Might be the video encoding too. I don't know, but. Yeah. Anyway, they very nearly cancel out. Requires more math than I've looked at to do this, exactly in detail. But you actually get for atmospheric turbulence that the size of the PSF is decreasing with wavelength like lambda to the minus 1/5. So almost flat. Right, and it must be something like on average it goes like that. Yeah, it's a good point though, that this is just the instantaneous PSF. Okay, and let's see. I think I have one more exercise here, which is actually looking at the sort of the time dependence of the PSF. So in these simulations that we run, we usually just assume that the pattern of phase is frozen in place and then just blows around with the wind. And that's where all the change in the wavefront comes from. So what I've got here is, let's see, oh, that's the wrong one. Anyway, this is a simulation where I've just got a single phase screen on the right, just to simplify things, and it's moving to the left, and then the PSF is evolving accordingly. And then my question is, for a single phase screen, Sort of what is the relation, and let's see, so it's, go through this slowly. For a single turbulent layer blowing to the north, so say it's blowing up the screen, how does the PSF variation over time at a single point in the focal plane relate to the variation in space, so at different points in the focal plane? Does that make sense? Okay. And then the tricky part is then, you know, how does that change with the altitude of that single layer? So any questions about the question? Okay, go for it. I mean, so there's only a single layer. Pretend there's only a single layer of atmosphere, and then just answer the question for three different altitudes, the same question.
I'm worried about our ability to breathe.
If there's only one layer of atmosphere, yeah, that's fair. I mean the variation in the PSF over the focal plane. Does that make sense? No. So by variation in space, I mean variation over the focal plane, like at a single instant in time. How is that related to the variation at one location of the focal plane over time?
On one location of the focal plane.
So imagine that wind turbulence was a checker. Yeah. Does it matter if the checker pattern is right by your face or it's 3 kilometers away?
No, just wanted.
Okay.
I wanted one of them to be zero, okay. And then the other two are kind of arbitrary.
It seems like with any of these questions, there's one expert in the audience. I'll be like, oh well, actually.
Yeah, it's tricky. It's yeah. Someone will complain. Yeah. We'll find out. See who it is. Yeah.
There's two scales. meters is always the same, but the amount of time it takes to cross the width of the 3.5 degrees increases. So,
all right, let's take a look at some simulations showing one layer moving at different altitudes. Okay, so this is part of the results for a single atmospheric screen at 0 kilometers, and then this is the whisker plot like Aaron showed in the previous lesson. Ignore the dots. Those are places where the computer I was using crashed, basically. So there's no data there. So this is a simulation. It's the most boring one, right? So this is across the field of view, right? Or a small part of a field of view for LSST. And if the layer is at 0 kilometers, then every part on the focal plane sees the same wavefront, right? So that's what's going on here. We can watch it dance around, but it's always the same. Now it gets more fun when you move up to, say, a kilometer. So now we can see these sort of waves of phase passing over the field of view, right? So what the PSF is doing down here at t equals zero becomes what the PSF is doing up here at some time later, depending on what the wind speed is in the simulation. Okay. And then so here's 3 kilometers. So what's changed here is the speed at which the phase screen is able to cross, and also sort of the scale of the variations is smaller now, because the physical scale of the variations is of course the same, but since it's at a higher altitude, it subtends a different angle. Okay, and then I think. Well, so it's a single layer atmosphere, but other than that, yes, this is for LSST like parameters.
So the frequency increased with the altitude. Does it have
So the frequency of the variation here increases with altitude for sort of fixed amount of turbulence in a screen. Right, so the question is, how does that spatial frequency depend on the altitude?
Yes.
Yeah, I think it ought to be linear. So the frequencies, sort of the characteristic frequency goes down inversely with the altitude. And I think I got a simulation here for 10 kilometers even. So now they're moving really slowly, but we got really sort of rapid differences in the PSF as a function of angle.
Is the scale here different than before? Because the 10 kilometers should be even smaller than the previous one, right? You pointed out it's a smaller angular scale.
So the field of view is the same on all of these. So maybe we mean something different by scale. I mean, it looks like the characteristic scale is smaller here. Does that make sense?
It should be smaller, right?
Right. Farther, right.
But the size of them
would. Oh, the size of each stick?
Is that what you're. The amount of movement between them looks larger or the same size as before. That's what I was surprised.
So the size of the stick shouldn't matter, I think, on what the altitude is, right? This is because You know, when we're taking our cookie cutter LSST aperture and projecting it up through the different layers, it doesn't care, you know, how far it had to go to do that, you know, to cut the cookie out of the layer. So the size of the sticks doesn't really matter, of the individual sticks doesn't depend on the altitude. What I meant by scale is like the amount of angle it takes to have a PSF like this transform into a PSF like this, that distance gets smaller as you increase the altitude. Okay.
No, that's a different effect. It's that the data you take at the bottom of the frame is taken, in our case, 55 seconds.
Right.
The data at the top. So the spatial and temporal variation kind of mixed up. The effect during the scanning is tiny.
Okay. And then I think, let's see. Here's the cumulative effect. So instead of looking at instantaneous PSFs, we're actually integrating over the 15 seconds. And you can watch that. And the interesting thing, I think, in this case is to look at what is the correlation look like horizontally versus, or you know, against the motion of the wind versus in the same direction as the wind. And let me just skip to the end here. I think it's clear that because the wind's moving this way, things are more correlated along the direction of the wind than they are against the direction of the wind. And that's just because, you know, this point up here has seen mostly the same atmosphere as this point down here, just delayed in time. But that's not true in the other direction. So this has an effect on the sort of the structure of the PSF correlation function.
Not to follow the object, but if you somehow magically knew the wind speed at all times, and you were clocking the chip so that it was following the screen, if it was only going in one direction.
If there's only one screen.
There's only one screen. I'm not saying you can do it, I'm just trying to understand what would happen.
So yeah.
If you did that, the effect would be that the PSF would be more stable? Would it be not changing?
It wouldn't be changing due to time. It would only be change due to sort of the intrinsic structure of the frozen turbulence.
It would be like you had this turbulent screen, but
it would be sort of independent of like the inner exposure time in that case.
Okay.
Yeah.
How good is the approximation that you have a frozen turbulent screen? Like, what's the decoherence time for atmospheric structure?
That's a good question. I don't know the answer to. It's certainly good enough in sort of the adaptive optics world where you're only looking at one point on the sky at a time and you just care about how long it takes for a phase to evolve as it crosses, you know, one telescope aperture. How good it is for LSST, where we have to worry about, you know, this entire 3.5 degree field of view, and it will take more than the 15 seconds for some of these high altitude layers to cross the field. And if the frozen flow approximation is still good in that case, I think it's more dubious.
It's about
2:30. Yep, so I'm done, but one more question, yep.
So, two questions, sorry.
Okay.
What you really have is you have all of these different layers.
Right.
The velocity's going in different directions.
Right.
And what you're seeing is the resulting.
It's the sum of all of that.
So the question I had is really, what's the time that the PSF stabilizes over? So you have your instantaneous speckles, and then you have an integration time. And then after a few minutes, then you have this stable.
So I do have a simulation showing the integrated PSF here. So here's the snapshot of the PSF and then a sum. And at least, and then there's the time, right? So it's pretty quick, actually. This is maybe not exactly LSST-like screens, but it's surprisingly quick that the PSF stabilizes and starts looking Kolmogorov. Now the, you know, at what level do we want it to be Kolmogorov is a harder question.
So Josh, for all these movies, the picture you're showing on the bottom is one source, and then the picture you're showing on the top is a whole bunch of sources, and you figured out the difference of...
So the pictures on the top, this is just the atmosphere. There's no sources per se.
That's just the plot of the density, phase difference in the
That's
atmosphere.
Right.
Uh-huh. Some of them, as I look up.
Mm-hmm. So this is the sum in this case.
And the thing that you show me on the bottom, is it for one point source?
Yeah, so this is one star, basically, one PSF. Mm-hmm. Right. Okay.
Great.
That's it.
Thank you.
Okay, so the next thing on the agenda is to go on the tour. I just checked the weather, and they said there's 0% chance of rain until 4:45. So I think we're okay. So Aaron and Kevin are going to be leading the tours. And how about, I'm going to see if we can actually get someone to stay here with the laptops, so you don't have to carry your laptops. Great. Tom is going to be the laptop guard. He's been down to IR2 many times. Yeah. So we're going to walk you down through the gate. Stay all together in a group, because we're taking you into the experimental area, where it's important that you stay with Kevin. He's going to give you some instructions, okay? Because this is inside the radiation-controlled area. So I'll hand it over to Kevin.
So I've summarized my the instructions that I'm supposed to share with you into three quick things. Obey, stay, and keep away. And those last two seem opposite. So if Aaron or I tell you not to go somewhere, don't go there. And if we say you should come with us, you should. Stay with us. Don't wander away. Somebody getting lost behind the second security gate would be not good for us. And if you see radiation signs, that's not the direction you want to move. We are going to take you into any RCAs, but if you wandered into one and got caught there, that will also be bad. So please just stay with us and make good choices. Great.
Oh.
And everybody needs to sign a piece of paper up here if you want to come with us.